Okay. Let's get the show on the road. Good afternoon, and thank you for joining us for another one of our webinars. My name is Tammy O'Connor, and I'm the CEO of Educational Innovations. EI's motto is teachers serving teachers, and we're committed to bringing the most awesome and engaging science materials into classrooms at affordable prices. We offer more than 1,000 innovative science products that make students sit up and take notice. So if you haven't visited our website lately, please be sure to swing by and check out all of our new products. As a reminder, on Thursday, February 23rd, we'll be presenting a webinar with our partners from Kids Making Sense using hands-on air quality sensor kits, and we'll be giving away a handheld sensor valued at $160. So please mark your calendar and join us in 3 weeks. And 4 weeks after that, we'll be hosting another webinar using Backyard Brains, our partners who specialize in bringing neuroscience technology into classrooms around the world. And if you're not already subscribed to our email newsletters, you can sign up on our website, or you can email me directly and I'd be happy to add you to the list. Today's topic is sensor starters with Databot, and our presenter is Robert Grover. Robert and his wife Heidi founded Databot in 2019, I guess that's right. And I'm pleased to say that EI has been carrying Databot since it first came out. Robert and Heidi have been involved in STEM education for years, and using all their experience, they created this fabulous learning tool for students. I have a few quick housekeeping items before we get started. If you have any questions at all during the presentation, please go to the Q&A section at the bottom of your screen and type them there. We've reserved some time at the end of our webinar so Robert can answer those questions. This will take place after the drawing, where one lucky participant will win a free Databot. So please remember, you have to be present to win. And at this point, I'll turn over the program to Robert Grover and Databot. Take it away, Robert.
Thank you very much, Tammy, and hello, everybody. Thanks for attending today. I think you'll find this very interesting, and we've got some free gifts for everybody, plus one lucky person will be winning a fantastic gift of a Databot. So as Tammy mentioned, Databot was founded by my wife and myself just before COVID, which was great timing. But we've been doing STEM education before it was called STEM. We started clear back in 1988 teaching students in an after-school program that focused on things like Lego engineering and teaching kids how to code. Sensors was something very early on back then. And over the years, we've seen things evolve, and we were very excited over the last 5 years as we saw a lot of the technology evolve that has made sensors so accessible and so inexpensive now that you can do a lot of the things that I'm going to be showing you with one simple device. It used to be that access to sensors and this kind of an experience would have been restricted to, you know, at earliest high school, and then even more frequently at university level, of course. And a lot of times the sensors were cumbersome. They're all individual. They're getting better and better now all the time. So now you've got wireless sensors. Ours is an all-in-one device, which I'm going to show you and explain a little bit to you. But the whole idea behind Databot is to, we call it democratize data and access to sensor information. It's friendly enough, tough enough that just about anybody should be able to use this device clear down to third, you know, even second grade. I've got a education specialist who specializes in elementary science who's working with it now clear down to the second grade level. So without further ado, let's go ahead and take a look at Databot. What we're going to cover today, go through the index here, and we may have more time, in which case I can show you more sensor starters and more applications. Just kind of depends on as we go through. This entire presentation, plus the lesson plan we're going to take a look at, is going to be available to you after this. Tammy will be sending it out to all of the registrations. So the first thing we're going to do is take a look at what Databot is. I call that slide Meet Databot. And then we're going to look at the kit contents. So the kits are very simple, very few materials. They're great for remote learning. They're great for simple storage, shipping, logistics. We've tried to keep the parts to a very low minimum. So you don't have to chase inventory all the time, but this one simple kit and device you can do many, many things with. The next slide after that, we're going to show you all of the different things that are on board Databot. And Databot's in a clear case. In fact, I'll hold one up here for you if you can see in the little video window. It's all crystal clear, so you can actually see the PCB inside. All of the sensors are labeled. And we'll go through, you know, the design, because that's really part of the whole learning experience as well, as kids can look at this thing and see what's going on. The next slide after that, we're going to jump right into using the free app. So everybody's going to have a chance to download the app, and we're going to go through a lesson plan that you could actually do in your classroom, you know, tomorrow. It's called Ninja Physics, and it allows you to interact with the force of gravity and acceleration just using the sensors on your smart device. So it'll work on tablets, iPads, your phones. So if you have an iOS or an Android device handy, and you're not watching the webinar on it, you should be able to download this app, and you'll be able to do this activity with all of us. And that's the best way to learn how this thing works. Because once you see how the app works, basically then instead of using the sensors on your phone, it's going to connect wirelessly to your phone, to the databot, and you'll have access to all of the different sensors that are on board the device at that time. So the topic of today is sensor starters, and we're focusing on this particular series of activities that we've developed to show you the format of them and really the intention behind them. You know, the whole idea behind sensor starters is to make educators and kids very familiar with the technology that's on board this little device. To that end, the sensor starters introduce you to the sensor itself, where it lives on the board, the technology behind it, how it's used in the real world, and we provide some great activities to get students starting to use it. The idea is behind, by the time you get through all of the sensors on this device using sensor starters, you should have a pretty good idea of what kinds of things you can do with that technology. And from there, you can go on to, you know, further explorations. The starters that I've got outlined today are acceleration, illuminance, the altimeter, altitude, sound intensity, ultraviolet. We have a number of others, so depending on where we're at, our time, we may be able to touch on a few more, but that'll be a good survey of lessons to give you an idea of what sensor starters look like and how you can apply them. All of these PDFs that you're going to be seeing are online in the Educational Innovations Databot area, so you can go in there and look at all of the different activities. The user guides are there, so you can actually pull up the user manual for Databot and look into more depth as to how it works and what kind of functions the software has. Also going to touch briefly on the NGSS standards. We're creating a whole scope and sequence of grade level driven activities using Databot that are framed around the NGSS, and then from there tying it to additional state standards. But one of the core practices of the NGSS, of course, are the science and engineering practices. And one of those is gathering and analyzing, interpreting data, which anytime students are using Databot, they're actually, you know, using that fourth practice, and it's becoming just secondhand. We'll take a look at some of the other software options that can be used with Databot. It's very versatile. It was designed to be not just a science tool, but also a STEM tool. So it's completely codable, integrates with robotic systems like Lego or Sphero or drones. We have a lot of drone activities. I'll show you one of those today. You know, again, the idea is to broaden awareness of sensors and scientific data. You have this whole invisible world of data that surrounds us, and it's designed to make data fun and engaging. And a lot of times when people hear the term data, it's not something that you really get up and jump around. You're excited to hear about. And we're trying to change that with the kinds of activities we'll be looking at in sensor starters today. Let's see, last thing, expandability using the Grove system. So in addition to the sensors that are on board this device, there are expansion ports, which I'll point out here in just a moment, that allow you to expand it into other areas. So there's a whole suite of additional sensors. A lot of them are very low cost that you can add into Databot. So if you're looking for pH or, you know, specific gas sensors, all of those are available. And then Tammy's going to give away a Databot kit. We'll do the drawing, and then we'll provide some extra time for the Q&A. So that's today's agenda. Again, you'll be getting a copy of this whole presentation for those of you who have registered afterwards. And I'm always available for questions. Just content information for educational innovations is at the end of this. And they're always great about fielding questions, and I'm always happy to provide more detail. We actually have all of the sensor data sheets if you're looking for more technical data, or lots of other use cases to show you how people are using it. So what is databot? So databot is a low-cost, friendly, engaging product for exploring science, data, and technology. The price on these is $189.99 for a single kit. It's $1,850 for a class pack of 10. And, you know, the cost differential when you compare it to other major sensor systems out there, you know, the major probeware providers like Vernier and Pasco, you know, to get the number of sensors that you have on this device would be 5 to 10 times the cost of what a databot is. Now, they're different paradigms. Databot's designed to be just super easy to use and provide quick access to all kinds of data so that kids can explore it. It's super tough. You can put it on things like catapults or drones or launch it on a rocket. It's designed to be used heavily. And probeware is a lot more rigorous, and it's a lot more expensive, but you know, they both have their place. So I would never put down Vernier or Pasco. They're fantastic products. This product is really a new category of product that opens up a whole world of access to not just scientific sensors, but playing with those sensors by coding and other things. So it's got a different purpose, and it's got a really strong fit from grades 4 clear through high school, clear into university, actually, because you can do some pretty advanced coding things with it. So anyway, that's what databot is. It's very, very small. The dimensions are there. It's 42.5 millimeters square by 20 millimeters tall, weighs 34 grams. That lightweight nature of it allows you to fly it around on small micro drones like the Tello. So we have lots of activities where people are doing that. But yeah, you know, the idea again is to make it very useful and have lots and lots of different applications. The sensors that are on board, which I'll go through here in just a moment, allow you to teach all kinds of topics. You can do chemistry, physics, life science. You can do activities in environmental science. The AI coding, applied math, lots of different things with one simple device. Other technical things we'll talk about on the next slide here. Guess the slide after this one. This is a quick look at what comes in the kit. So the kit is all housed in one little soft case, like so. A class pack of 10 takes up about the space of a shoebox. So they're very easily stored. Again, they're very tough. These soft cases are twin packs. So you store two of the databots per case. And the materials that come with it, as I mentioned, very simple to keep track of the inventory. Comes with a temperature probe. The temperature probes are waterproof, so you can drop them into a beaker or a stream. Databot supports two simultaneous temperature probes, so you can take two different temperature readings from different parts of your experiment simultaneously. There's a lanyard, which is that little blue thing, looks like this. It actually goes through the corner. There's a little corner loop on Databot, and you can connect to that lanyard, and you can swing it like a pendulum, swing it like a bolo, wear it around your neck and go for a run. Collect data. And then the last item there, of course, is the little charging cable and coding cable. And there's numerous coding environments for it. The battery on board, which I'll talk about next, actually. So that little cable is for both coding and charging. And down here at the bottom of the databot, if you're holding it with the single port towards the back, is the charging coding port. So the battery on board is a 500 milliamp hour battery. And that's one of the first things that people ask about, well, how long will it last? For a 1 hour charge, it'll run about 5 to 6 hours. So it's a pretty much ideal. I mean, I've talked with educators who have used it in the classroom all day long, and kids use it for maybe 10 to 20 minutes, sometimes 30 minutes per session. By the end of the day, it's still got plenty of power. You just recharge it and they're ready to go again the next day. It's also possible to add on external power supplies. So for example, here's a good example. We have a group of schools in Germany actually doing a high altitude balloon launch competition this quarter. And all the kids are putting together experiments that they want to go up on that balloon. But the balloon ride is going to be, you know, longer than the battery life, and also gets very cold up there. So they're adding on an external power supply, which is essentially just a phone battery bank. So you can do things connected to Bluetooth with this device, which is what we're going to try with Visi today. Or you can take it offline and it'll store the data internally and you can download it after the experiment. But anyway, the battery, again, about an hour to charge it, 4 to 6 hours, depending on what you're doing with it. So a quick physical tour of this device, going counterclockwise from the upper left-hand corner here. This is the two probe ports. So again, supports two temperature probes. The kit comes with one. An additional probe is only $10. So if you're looking at doing experiments that require two probes, it's a very small price to add on. The click switch is the next one down, and it's actually built into the case. This case is smooth all the way around, so no protuberances. Makes it very easy for kids to do things where it's going to be sliding or, again, mounted on rockets or doing different things. But essentially, there's a little lever pad there built into the plastic case. One click on, one click off. The picture there shows it on. So when you click it and turn it on and it's upright, it's going to come on in what we call Visi mode. Again, Visi is the software you're going to try today. And it'll connect to it by Bluetooth. And as soon as you're connected to it, you can select, you know, which sensors that you want to display and collect the data around. You'll see how easy Visi is to use. While we're talking about that particular illumination, there's three RGB LEDs built into databot, right? So that little indicator shows you when it's in Bluetooth mode. But if you're coding, you can turn on all of those in different colors. I think I have this one coded. You'll see this one's all lit up if you look in the little video window again. This is actually a little piece of code I'll show you in a little while, which gives you an example of how kids can use this for physical computing. But each one of those LEDs is individually controlled and can be any color. So some neat physical computing opportunities with that as well. There's also a tone generator built into it. So that allows you to do the physical output. So you can have things like alarms, you can have things where it plays music. These are all great coding activities, right? So physical computing aspects. And then last, you've got two extra ports over here on the right-hand side. And those are for integration with other systems. So for example, we tie it into the Sphero rover. You can tie it into Lego systems. You can add on additional sensors like what I was describing a little while ago. So lots of ways to use this device beyond just for the science that I'm going to be showing you. That's the neat thing about it is that the more people use it, the more people that understand it, the more use it can get within your school. We have lots of programs where engineering teachers and science teachers are all using it together in various ways. So over here on the right-hand side, this is the list of sensors. And what we'll do is just a quick rundown of where they live on the board. And when we do these sensor starters, which are coming up, you'll be able to see which ones are being used within that sensor starter. So it's hard to go through all 15 of these within the short amount of time we have, but I'll give you a quick tour. The accelerometer, which records acceleration. The gyroscope, which is going to be reading rotational speed or angular velocity. And the magnetometer, which reads magnetic fields, are all built into one sensor module, which is right in the middle of the databot. And that's so, for example, if you're spinning it, you can be spinning it and calculating the rotational speed, which is one of the activities that we have kids do. There's also an air pressure sensor that's on board. And the air pressure is here. And using air pressure, you can calculate altitude, right? So there's a relationship between air pressure and the altitude you are at. That's actually one of the sensor starters we'll look at today, which is a great indication or introduction to students about that relationship and how sometimes one kind of data that may be unrelated or seemingly unrelated to something can actually tell you something else. And that in this case, it's going to be air pressure is going to tell us altitude. So ambient light, color, and gesture are another module. It's this sensor in the center that's labeled light. And what you can do with like the color sensor is pretty interesting because it'll break down your light wavelengths into red, green, and blue. So there's all kinds of experiments you can do with indirect and reflected light. The ambient light, of course, is just light intensity, which is one of the sensor starters we'll look at today. And then gesture is a is primarily used for coding. Databot will recognize if you sweep right or you sweep left or up or down. And of course, you can have things happen based on what it's sensing. So there's a gesture sensor built in. Humidity in the upper right-hand corner of the device. Proximity, so there's a what's called a time of flight sensor. It's bouncing a laser signal off of a an object, and it calculates the distance based on the time that signal takes to travel. So that's available as well. There's a microphone on board, so that allows you to do sound intensity explorations. And that's actually one of the sensor starters we'll look at today as well. There's a temperature probe, which you've already talked about. Ultraviolet light, it'll report the UV index. It's reading the UVA wavelengths, and it'll calculate the UV index. The sensor starter for that introduces students to what is ultraviolet radiation, shows you how to read the index, check it locally on your weather station, and it introduces concepts about why you should be aware of ultraviolet radiation and why it's important for your health. I think the last two, I left off CO2, carbon dioxide, and volatile organic compounds are also a air quality module that's on board there and allows you to take CO2 readings and also investigate volatile organic compounds, which is quite interesting because you can do studies inside the classroom and identify objects that might be off-gassing, and you get to learn about the health hazards of VOCs, what they are, chemically, how they're interacting with the environment. Technical information for any of you out there who are Uber geeks. This device is built on an ESP32, which has built-in Wi-Fi and Bluetooth capabilities. And then we've got 4 megabytes of RAM on board, which is plenty to store lots of data if you want to send this thing off on data collection missions and then recover it later. So now we're going to take a look at how to use Databot. And this is the simplest out-of-the-box way to use it. It's using our app, which we call Visi. Visi stands for visualize data. And we've made it very simple to use. So it pre-configures experiments. The tap of an icon allows you to connect to Databot and immediately start collecting and using data. So again, one of the biggest things that we have focused on is that user experience to make sure it's friendly and easy for educators. So and students. We want to make sure that getting to the data is easy and getting the data out of the system is easy, which this particular software does very nicely. So essentially, again, just to reiterate, when you turn on your databot, you select an experiment, it'll connect, and you can immediately start streaming data. So let's go ahead and try Visi out. This is the hands-on part of this webinar, which is the fun part. I'm going to have you look up Visi on your App Store or your Play Store. So it's either Android or iOS. You should see a very colorful rainbow colored V there for Visi. And I'll give you a moment to download. As you download and install this, I'll tell you a little bit more about some use cases for Visi. It works great on all, you know, smartphones, iPads. So we've got different programs, for example, one-to-one connections with iPads. If you're in a particular school or district that uses that allows the students to use smart devices, bring their own phones, you can install it on the on their own phones. This app records no personal information, so there's no login information, no privacy issues. It's all self-contained. All you're doing is collecting the data, and it allows you to export that data. But no information of the user is collected or reported back to anybody. So no login required. The software is completely free. And we encourage you to distribute this activity that we're going to be sharing with all of your friends. We have people using Ninja Physics, which is the activity we're going to be doing. We literally have people all over the world doing it. So I always get great pictures of and videos of kids doing the ninja walk in Africa and India and fun places like that. So I'm going to take one short break. And Tammy, you can interrupt me if anybody's having problems. If you're unable to install the app, you can certainly do it after the webinar. and just inquire through Tammy and we'll be able to get you set up. It really is easy to use. So if you're not in a position or space right now where you can actually do it, that's fine. We can make sure you can try it later after the webinar. So after you've installed the app, and Tammy, go ahead and interrupt me if somebody's got a question or if there's anything that I need to answer, but I'll just continue. After you install the app, you're going to be presented with a blank screen. That's just the welcome screen for Visi. And what you want to do is look for the plus sign on your screen. If it's an Android device, you'll probably see the plus down in the lower right-hand screen. If it's an iPhone device, it'll be up in the upper right-hand portion of the screen. And it's going to give you an option for scanning experiments by QR code. And the QR code that is displayed on the screen is the one that you want to scan. So you want to scan that through Visi, not just with your camera. Visi will recognize the file format, and it will bring this collection of experiments in. So briefly, to explain collections, one of the things that makes Visi and databot very easy to use is we use these QR codes on the lesson plan so that you scan the QR code. It brings in whatever experiments you need pre-configured and allows you to get right to the activities. So you don't have to worry about, set up or trying to get things prepared in advance. It's all right there for you. So if this has all worked for you, wherever you are, you should have brought in a set of experiments called Ninja Physics Smart, which you'll see on the little screen there. And you should have four activities. And we're going to do two, maybe three of those. I think we've got enough time to do at least two of them. And it'll give you a good idea of how the app works, because the app works the exact same way with databot. You'll just be connecting to an external sensor instead of an internal sensor. Now, knowing educators, I'm sure you're already doing this, but I'm going to have you go ahead and start with 3D Basics, which is the very first experiment. You tap on that, and you'll see at the top a little play icon. And so it turns from pause to play. When you hit play and it starts streaming live data, you will be seeing the live data coming from your accelerometer on your phone. At this moment, I'm going to switch over so we can actually look at this particular set of activities. So this is the Ninja Physics curriculum unit. And this is also something that Tammy's going to send out to everybody. So for those of you who are attending, you'll get the copy of the slides we're going through. But you also get a complete copy of the teacher's guide and the math support documents, plus this lesson unit. And it's something, again, that you can use in your classroom with your kids, right away. It's a fun activity where kids are actually exploring that magical invisible force of acceleration. They start learning about gravity because you can actually visualize the numbers that are related to the force of gravity. And they learn about things like the nature of acceleration through physically interacting with it. So just brief, this is called an exploration. The activities we're going to be looking at today after this are, again, sensor starters, which are just two-page activities. Explorations are longer. They have several activities within them, a lot more background and support information. So the activity we're doing right now, 3D Basics, I imagine you're all playing with that. I'm going to skip through all the background information here, and we'll get to that so that we can actually do some playing. So using Visi, and the app itself, you should have your 3D Basics running. And I'm going to give you an example here. If you hold your phone out flat on your palm in front of you and look at the live data, you should be seeing on the Z-axis, and the Z-axis in this case is going straight up through the phone, because if you think about it, your accelerometer is a flat chip and it's laying there on this circuit board inside your phone. The Z-axis goes right through that chip. As you hold it flat in your palm, you should see something close to the gravitational constant here on the planet Earth, which is 9.8 meters per second squared. So, the challenge here that we're going to get kids to, we call it a steady hand, is trying to hold a phone or a sensor or a data bot perfectly steady for a period of 10 seconds, what captures data, and then it's going to score them, right? So this is ninja training. You're getting the opportunity to test out how steady your hand is, how smoothly you can walk in the next activity. So if you've been exploring with the 3D Cartesian coordinates, you will have probably figured out by now also that if you rotate the phone upright, you will see that force of gravity that's being displayed is now shifted to the Y-axis, which is going this way. And then if you go left or right, you're going to see gravity shift to the x-axis. And it'll be either positive or negative, depending on which orientation you go to. Now, the real life application of this in your smart devices is probably pretty obvious. When you rotate your device from portrait to landscape, how does it know to change the picture? Well, it uses the accelerometer. It notices the force of gravity has shifted to a different axis, and it'll rotate the picture, you know, appropriately to make it work. So anyway, it's a great introduction. This particular first 3D basics activity is a great introduction to 3D Cartesian coordinates, because you're physically working with the X, the Y, the Z axis, and you're looking at gravity on all those axes. So it's a fun free form exploration for kids. So the next one, and our time is moving fairly quickly, I think we'll just do this one, but you can do the other activities at home and with your kids. We're going to do a steady hand, which follows up on this activity that we just did with the freeform exploration. Now, steady hand, to get to it, if you're still inside your 3D basics, there's a little back arrow that you'll see on the screen. See if you notice here on the screen where it says a steady hand, there's a back arrow that points to the left. It'll take you back out to the main menu, and then you select your next experiment. Now, a steady hand is a timed experiment. So Visi allows you to grab specific data sets of time. So you can set a timed run. If you want to take a 20-second data collection or a two-hour data collection, you can do that. In this case, it's going to be a 10-second collection, and it gives you a 3-second delayed start. So at the top of your menu, you'll notice the number 3.0. You'll see the little arrow pointing to the right. When you tap on the arrow, you'll notice that that number starts to count down. And as soon as it hits zero, it'll begin that 10-second data set collection. And the idea, of course, is to practice your steady hand, and it's actually going to score you. So the closer you can get to an average of 9.8 meters per second squared over that 10-second time, the better your ninja score is going to be. So this is very, it's very physically interactive for kids and educators. I have teachers actually push one another so they get better scores, right? But the competition piece is fun. But by the time you're done with that, kids never forget 9.8 meters per second squared because they've been, of course, staring at it through the entire activity. So anyway, that's a good example of how Visi works. And again, just to reiterate, if you have a databot, you scan in the QR code, let's say carbon dioxide, you tap on the CO2 icon, it'll connect to databot and it'll immediately start streaming the CO2 values in the room. And there's lots of capabilities beyond that within Visi. The entire user manual is on Educational Innovations website, and you can download and look at those in more detail. And there are options for exploring data, zooming in and identifying data points and doing linear regressions and all kinds of fun stuff. So the app itself is very simple. Getting the data out of this app is also very simple. And I'll mention that just one time here before we move on to the next piece of the webinar. The upper right-hand corner of each experiment, you'll notice three dots. And within that three-dot menu, that's where you can export your data. So if you've done your ninja steady hand exercise, you could actually go up there and export that data, and whatever sharing options are enabled in your device, you can use to export the data. So you could text it to yourself, you could email it to yourself, you can download it to your local Google Drive or your AirDrop. Lots of ways to get the data out. It'll come out as an Excel or a CSV file, so it's very portable. You can take it into just about anything. But it's that easy to collect data and export the data. So that is an introduction to how databot works with Visi. And now the next piece that we're going to go through are the sensor starters. And sensor starters, again, this is the format of them. You'll see two pages here. There's just a front and back, and we provide the PDFs for download. They're very simple in nature. They're designed to be something that can be done probably in about 15 minutes. You can go longer with some of them, but the idea is to make it a fun, interactive exploration of data that gets kids excited about using these sensors and helps make everybody comfortable with the technology as well. So briefly, we'll go through the layout of a sensor starter. And you'll notice we start out with meet the accelerometer, right? And it tells you, what does that accelerometer do? Well, it senses motion. And we talk about how it's used. So accelerometers are everywhere, obviously, in the device that we were just using. And they're also in cars, planes, all kinds of things. They even use them for collecting data on machines that are running. Let's say you've got a battery of freezers and you use an accelerometer to be monitoring the vibrations of all of those freezers. You can tell if one of the compressors is starting to fail. So things like that. Accelerometers are probably one of the most ubiquitous sensors on the planet. We talk about what it measures. We talk a little bit about how it works. So each one of these sensor starters will give you a brief introduction to the technology behind it. If you're teaching more advanced classes, if you're at high school and you want to know all the technical details about that sensor, that's all on the website as well. So we provide the full technical data sheet, everything about how the sensor's working, the resolution, other applications. And you can see that they're real world industrial sensors because those data sheets actually talk about use cases in the real world. Units is always included. So students are becoming familiar with, you know, we're measuring something. What is the unit that measures acceleration? What is the unit that measures humidity? That's your important terminology that you're going to be introduced to. There's a QR code that you scan in if you don't have that sensor already scanned in. When you first set up your databot, you bring in all of the core sensors. So most of the sensor starter icons will already be loaded in. But in some cases, we have some extra ones for these sensor starters that you bring in. And then finally, we talk about where does that live? And as I had mentioned earlier when we were doing our databot tour, it lives right in the center of the board. So it's called an IMU, and that's what it's labeled. It's an inertial measurement unit. And that's where your gyro, your accelerometer, and your magnetometer all live. Second page of a sensor starter looks like this. So you'll notice you have two activities, and we call them PDQs, which stands for pretty darn quick. Again, the idea is we know how busy teachers are, but we want these activities to be fun and engaging and captivating. So we don't want them to go on too long, but we want them to be long enough that students have learned something about the sensor and they've interacted with the data, and hopefully they're piqued and interested enough that they want to explore further. Our experience has been that they're very successful. In fact, some of the slides here that I'll show you next were all from another teacher, a public school teacher in DC schools. Actually did a community service project with a bunch of students, and they all did these activities themselves and then filled out surveys afterwards as to how effective they were. And the results were fantastic. You know, the idea is to continue improving these activities and get kids excited again about data. So the two activities for the accelerometer, we introduce them again to the XYZ axis, scaling on VISI. And then they're actually challenged in hop, skip, run, race, or jump to achieve the highest level of acceleration possible. As they hold databot to their chest. So they learn about the nature of acceleration. It's not just a change in the rate of speed if you're going forward. It's also a change in direction. So there's lots of ways to change your acceleration. In Ninja Physics, we talk about that by trying to get, we challenge students to move with zero acceleration on their y-axis. So there are a lot of these physical activities that really bring a lot of these physics concepts home because you're physically experiencing them. So that is the layout of a sensor starter. Let's actually take a look at this one so you can see what it looks like. And this is Jonte Lee. He's the teacher I was telling you about from DC schools that did all of these activities with his kids. And the survey results you'll see there in the upper right-hand corner. This one was pretty popular. The most popular one of all was the sound one, which I'll show you here as well. We've got about 17 minutes left, so we've got time to explore these a little bit. And I've got, I think, five of them laid out. But I like the quotes. This presentation will be sent to you, but gives you an idea of the kinds of things that students are doing with it. My favorite part of this exercise is when I saw my friend do the moonwalk. So they're exploring, you know, with physics, physically, which is great fun. We have another teacher that's doing work with, they're actually doing dance with the data. So they're trying to match dancing graphs based purely on data. So interesting things start to evolve as people start to use these and become more familiar with the data itself. So let's see here. Let's actually take a look at the activity itself. I've got my browser open. So what I'm doing here is actually just going between tabs. That's why I'm not in presentation mode. But I'll show you the sensor starters live on Educational Innovations website. If you go to our databot address, which is in this presentation, and you scroll down, you'll see where you can download a lot of information on databot. And this is where the sensor starters and activities live. You can actually download those PDFs and do them yourself. So we'll open up this tab. This is what the PDF looks like. Same format that we just looked at on the slide. And this one, I'll zoom in a little bit and show you an example of one of the features of Visi. If we go down here, you'll notice you actually open the data set up and you can tap on different points to see what that data point reads at. So you can get very precise. So kids who are competing to get the highest level of acceleration, for example, here they're physically exploring a data set and trying to identify their peak moment of acceleration. So lots of great skills that they're acquiring in these sensor starters. Let's take a look at another one. So this one is using the ambient light sensor, illuminance. And this particular activity introduces kids to the measurement of illuminance, first of all. And the first activity in the sensor starter has them explore the room, find the lightest and the darkest spots in the room, right? And then you move on to this activity, which is where you're actually studying the relationship between the distance from the light source and the intensity. And there's a very pure mathematical relationship. It's called the inverse square law, and kids can actually start to see that as they experiment with a meter stick and the distance from a light source. Again, you can see some of the quotes here. Favorite part was collecting the data, which, you know, that means this is working. We've got kids getting excited about using data and sensors in the classroom. Something I learned is that light is locked. So that's great. They're learning their units. All this technical nomenclature that's associated with science that's tied to these sensors becomes secondhand when you're using them physically and doing activities like this. Here's our rating. Looks like we had 27%, most awesome engaging learning experience ever. About 45% found it interesting. 9% didn't much like it. It was better than going to the dentist. But I figure most of them liked it. There's always one in a crowd, right? So let's take a look at that particular sensor starter. So I'm gonna switch tabs here. This is the PDF for ambient light. Again, we show where it's located on the board, explain how the sensor is actually working, talking a little bit about photodiodes. Give you an example of real world conditions. So in full daylight, 10 to 16,000 lux or more, indoor classroom, 300 to 700, which is an enormous change. One of the things that you really notice when you experiment with this particular sensor is if you're inside and you go outside, you become very aware of how much brighter daylight is. I didn't realize myself until I actually had that experiment, but when you're sitting in a brightly lit classroom, the difference between that light and when you go outside, tremendous difference. And here's the activities again. Again, you have your two PDQs that you do. This is where they're using it in the palm of their hand and they're hunting for the bright and the dimmest spot in the room. And then here's the activity with the varying distance and the intensity of light. Very simple activities to do, but you're reinforcing, again, that data collection, data interpretation, the fourth practice of the NGSS. You're getting kids ready for the data-powered world that is today. Everything is data-powered, no matter what job you're in. It's like we have about 13 minutes left. Let's do another one. So this one's the altimeter. This is actually one of my favorites. Just because it's so physical, you've got kids actually running up and down stairs and measuring things, so a lot of physical activity. So with the altimeter, of course, I mentioned mentioned this earlier, you've got that relationship between air pressure and altitude. So kids actually start to understand how you can calculate seemingly unrelated outputs based on other data. This one, purpose of this activity was to calculate the current altitude based on air pressure. Let's look at some of the quotes. This person actually learned uses air pressure to determine the altitude. This person liked looking up the altitude of the school, comparing it to the current altitude, because you got to see real data against data that was already taken. You know, interesting, that's actually an interesting one, because they're starting to realize, you know, verifying data. And that's one of the things that we emphasize pretty consistently throughout all of our activities is critical thinking and learning how to look beyond what may be presented to you and look at the underlying data, which we all need to learn how to do, especially with so much misinformation being distributed these days. We need kids to be able to think analytically and critically using the data at hand. So in this activity, you can see this student's running up and down the stairs, and you can see the graph output here. It's pretty interesting. You look up the activity, or you look up the altitude. Let's jump over here to the actual sensor starter. You use Google Earth, and you can look up your elevation at any particular point, right? And then you go outside so that you're on the ground floor and you calibrate your databot to that exact altitude. Calibration with databot needs to be done for humidity, altimeter, and then also for the temperature probes if you're going to be doing two decimal places worth of accuracy. Typically, you only have to calibrate them once at the beginning when you do your setup, unless you've done something where you've, you know, overwritten the firmware, you're doing things with coding or things like that. But calibration is pretty simple. You look it up, and this is the actual activity here. You look it up, enter it into the little entry form here, hit start, and then it will adjust the altitude for your current altitude. And then the kids actually go on to measure the accuracy of the device, and that's when they're running up and down the stairs. So in this particular example, we do three runs. They go up and down the stairs three times. They average the results of the altitude, and they come out with, okay, this was the distance that the data bot traveled up and down. And then we have them physically measure it with a tape measure and see how close it is. And it's remarkably accurate. It's within a few centimeters, you know, less than a couple of inches. And it's a great introduction, again, to the concept of air pressure, on how you calculate altitude from air pressure. It's also a great introduction to just calibration, looking up alternative sources of data, comparing accuracy. There's just a lot of great things in this activity. It's, again, one of my favorites. Okay, I think we're down to about 10 minutes. We might need to move on. We've got a few more sensor starters, but what we can do is come back to them if we have more time. So again, that was altimeter. I'll briefly talk about these as we go through them, but I won't spend much time on it. Sound intensity, this one the students learn about decibel levels, right? They also learn what decibel levels are dangerous, and they learn about how you read decibel levels using sound intensity. And then the challenging part in the PDQ is this fun where you're trying to match sound waves based on the intensity of your voice. So the picture here is this student trying to make a graph of a round mound. You know, the challenges are doing a round mound, make square waves, make triangular spikes, all just by controlling the volume of your voice, right? So very challenging. This actually, I think, was the most popular when we looked at the total numbers. I think kids just like to make noise. Ultraviolet radiation using the UV sensor. This particular sensor starter, you look, again, you go to the weather online and you check the weather data for the day, and you'll have the UV index available. And then the kids go out and they compare it to the sensor data that they get. Now, the case on DataBot is made of polycarbonate, which has some natural characteristics for blocking ultraviolet light, which is a great introduction to material science also. But there's an opening on the DataBot that allows you to pin a little shadow circle right on the sensor. And I call that the shadow sight. I say, kids, use your shadow sight. You pin that shadow sight right on the sensor, and you'll get a UV index number that typically matches exactly to what the weather station, you know, shows. And then extensions of that activity are using different materials trying to block UV rays. and blended into that whole sensor starter is just the importance of understanding ultraviolet radiation and the damage it can cause to your skin. Drones. I think we've got time probably just to look at this quick drone activity. Again, these activities are all on the Educational Innovations website. But in this particular one, you're using a Tello drone, which looks like this, and you mount databot on it with a 3D printed mount, and it'll ride on there. And when we do these drone missions, we do two students per mission. One student's the pilot, one's the data scientist, and the data scientist will be collecting information, whether they're collecting carbon dioxide, or in this case, they're trying to measure the height of the ceiling using the proximity sensor and the altimeter together. So it's a great way for kids to work together and actually be collaborating to collect and analyze data and use it for, you know, real world purposes, which is what it's all about. Because data, again, everywhere. I've already mentioned this a couple of times. The fourth practice within the NGS is analyzing and interpreting data. And anytime that they're doing activities like we've just looked at, obviously they're collecting data. And depending again on what grade level you're working with, there's lots and lots of things you can do to go into the data analysis in depth. You can take these into spreadsheets or other software you may have available and do all kinds of fun stuff. Quick 60 seconds of other ways to use databot. Okay, so databot is a very versatile piece of hardware. So you can put other software on it. You can stream data live from it into Excel. You can code it with this drag and drop environment. Lots of neat things. You can put MicroPython on it. So if there's some technology teachers out there, you download MicroPython to this, you have access to all of those sensors, and you can actually do machine learning exercises with kids, program it directly using MicroPython. Very low floor in terms of being able to get started right out of the box with simple science activities. Extremely high ceiling on the technical end, as well as other things you can do with the science. I had mentioned expansion. So there's a lot of these low-cost sensors that are available out there that can connect to databot with these expansion ports. And this is just a summary. I think a lot of the things I've talked about, because of the versatility of it, you know, it's great for all kinds of programs. So you're doing CTE programs, you're teaching fourth grade science, you're teaching math. We have a lot of math teachers that take data from databot itself and from activities, take it into Desmos and do calculations and fun activities, again, to make math more exciting and interesting. Anyway, lots and lots of opportunities. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Tammy. We've got about 4 minutes left, I think. And I know she's anxious to announce the raffle winner.
Thank you, Robert. That was fabulous. We had a couple of questions along the way, and there aren't a lot of them. I was, believe it or not, because we've done so many of these, I was actually able to answer some of them on my own. So I'm very pleased with that. In any event, I know that you're all sitting around waiting to see who won the databot. And today's winner is Deb Springman. So Deb, please email me, and we will send you out your databot. If you make sure that you send me your mailing address, we will get it out to you. So congratulations, it's very exciting. Okay, now Robert, do you have access to the Q&A down at the bottom?
I don't see it anyway, so it's probably more effective for you just to ask.
I can do that. Okay, so we have a participant who's asking, for VOCs, does it break them down?
And then it gives you a single output number of volatile organic compounds, and it's based on, it's reading hydrogen molecules. The data sheet that's online would give you very specific information as to what it's providing, but it gives you a parts per billion of VOCs, but it doesn't break them down specifically.
Okay. And the follow-up to that is also, is the VOC sensed by an IAQ?
Is the sensor by IAQ? Mm-hmm. No, I don't believe it is.
It says, is it sensed by IAQ?
So IAQ indoor air quality. I'm not sure I quite understand the question, I guess.
I don't know, Mark, that's one of your questions. So if you want to follow up with that question, we will come back to it.
Yeah, I'll be happy to provide more information, including the data sheet afterwards.
Okay. Perfect. And another great question is, if my high school student misuse or abuse this device, is there a way to easily determine if the device is undamaged when they check it back in? Is there a way to quickly and easily know if the battery is fully charged or partially charged?
Yes, there's a set of system tools, and the system check, you just tap on that and it'll tell you the battery charge level. It'll also tell you the firmware and that sort of thing on there. In terms of testing the databot, there's a master display for all of the sensors. And that's what we use to test these before we ship them out. We hit the master display and it streams all of the data from all of the sensors simultaneously. So you can make sure they're all still working.
Terrific. And Dan is asking, what is the max speed of data collection? For example, if my sensor can output at 100 kilowatts, can databot record that? And if not, what is the max recording range, kilohertz?
Right. So each sensor has its own particular recording range, right? Databot is set for 100 samples per second by default. And what you have to do is you would look at the data sheet for each sensor if you're trying to do something very specific with one of the sensors that's on board and see what the resolution of that sensor is. Because you don't use Visi for that, you would actually connect to it with our server mode, we call it, and you would select the sensor and the particular sample rate that you want. And the sample rate possibilities would be determined by that data sheet. So we'd have to look at each one. Again, I can follow up specifically with more technical questions like that afterwards.
Okay, terrific. And we do have the clarification from Mark. Is the sense an IAQ from AMS?
The manufacturer? The manufacturer of that particular sensor is Sensoron.
Okay. All right, because I'm looking at that and I'm thinking, I don't even understand the question, let alone know the answer. Susan wrote, as did a couple of other people, every question I started to ask was answered before I finished typing. Yay. So that's kudos to you, Robert. Good job. That's all of our questions. And so I think that this was wonderful. I wanted to thank you. And for all of you, if you'd like to share this with any of your colleagues, or if you'd like to refer back to it, we'll be sending out the recording, I would say probably within the week, and it will also be available on our website at the bottom of the databot page. So if for some reason you lose that link, you can always find it again. So thank you everybody for joining.
Thank you very much for having me.
Sorry, Robert. I just want to remind everybody that we have at least two more webinars coming up, and be sure to check out your email, and we will be highlighting all of them and sending them out to you within the next couple of days. Robert, thank you so much again, and we'll be sure to have you back.
Thank you. It's been fun.
Enjoy the rest of the week, everyone. Take care.